Hello and welcome to the 8th race of the 2014 PCC Cup Series season here at the unique Chicago Speedrome in Chicago, Illinois. This track is incredibly interesting. It's the second time it's been on the schedule. First time was in 2012 when it was newly constructed. And this track has 8 different turns with the four pairs of turns have different bankings, different elevations, and different radii, so it's going to be incredibly interesting to see how the drivers tackle this unique circuit here today. Paloma Autosport has done an incredible job getting their cars up at the front of the field, and Ian Elias and Lenny Jacobs are going to lead the field to the green flag in race number one. We're back at the twin race format after the one-off race at Mansfield, which was an overcapacity event. There are something like 150 odd cars that were entered in that race. But we're back at the twin race format. There are 80 cars that showed up for this race, so 40 in each race, 40 in race one, 40 in race two. Your points leader, Silvia Rinaldi, is starting incredibly deep in the field. She's starting, I believe, 32nd in this race. And Laris Ryu, one of the other championship contenders, is also starting deep in the field. As we look at the starting grid for race number two now, Brian Gallagher is on the pole for race number two. And he won the pole by about 0.4 of a second over Greg Woodard. So he has just been flying here today. He's really just been a master of the speedways so far this year. Going through the field there, you see Ben Atkins starting in ninth place. And Johnson Racing has improved drastically since Mansfield. They reportedly underwent a restructuring with their engine program, and they've really revamped everything sort of at the loss of reliability. But from what we've seen from the Johnson Racing cars, they have picked up their times by about half a second. Going back, you see there Wayne Newman. Wayne Newman is a PCC Lights driver. Syzygy Engineering, owner of the number 42 with Jeff Fisher and Wayne Newman, are two PCC Lights drivers who entered their PCC Cup cars into this race because it's a companion week. And we also have Wayne Coulter in this race. He ran at Mansfield, and he's going to try and do another race here, building off of his successes from the Mansfield race 2 weeks ago. Now, Ian Elias leads the field to the green flag here, and it looks like Isaac Michaels already in the background is getting a jump on Lenny Jacobs there for second place. Lenny Jacobs starting to fall back on the high side, and Isaac Michaels still side by side. Looks like he's going to take second place over from Lenny Jacobs in the 52 there, but Paloma Autosport, the 52 and 32 cars have just been absolutely dominant here today. It looks like Lenny Jacobs is making a move on the inside as Ian Elias begins to pull away from the rest of the field. You see they're filing down this change in altitude into this tight left-hand turn. Looks like he's starting to gap a little bit there. Here's Silvia Rinaldi, your points leader, and she's in 35th place, 3/4 of the way through lap one, and it is just getting worse for her. See there Robert Nelson coming on the inside. She's going to work her way around Frank Azzaretto there. You see Laris Ryu in the background too. She's doing even worse, so two of the top drivers in the point standings are just having miserable starts to their races here in Chicago. Now, Isaac Michaels is up to second place. He had a really good run going for him at Mansfield, but unfortunately he was involved in a wreck close to halfway through the race, and that relegated him to a pretty poor finish. So he's trying to get back up towards the front and really challenge and try and move up in the point standings. Here's Laris Ryu, who I mentioned before. She's running in 36th by lap two, trying to get around Scott Wullen and Nick Azure there. Speaking of Nick Azure, he just hit the wall, and he hit Silvia Rinaldi, and he is all over the track. Guess that's how he got back there. He had some damage on both sides of his car, so that's where it came from. Here's Ryan Griffin, one of the championship contenders, and he's running in 7th place right now, side-by-side with Cameron Taylor. He had a really good run at Mansfield, and he's going forward, definitely running in the top 10 there. There's Chris Washer, and he's having a surprisingly strong run as well. Here's onboard Lenny Jacobs, and you see he's starting to close in on the top two of Ian Elias and Isaac Michaels. Michaels kind of having some trouble catching Ian Elias. Those cars look about matched. Elias's might be a little better, and Lenny Jacobs is just hanging just in the draft of Isaac Michaels, hanging back a little bit. Whitney Fuller making a move on the inside of Barry Juveno for the fifth position. Whitney Fuller possibly rumored to be out of this car by the end of the season. Owner Tanner Clayson is not too happy with her performance as compared to Duncan Cobb. But Fuller is trying to prove him wrong here today by running up in the top 10. And she's doing quite a good job, actually. Not really known for her road course prowess, but definitely proving that she can do really well on the super speedways and speedways here today. Casey Lester is up in 18th place, and he looks to transfer onto race one for California, the next race. And there's James Hewitt in front of him as well, doing a good job. Both of these cars are fairly underfunded. They're not the best cars in the field by any stretch of the imagination, but they're doing what they can with the equipment that they've got. Here comes Duncan Cobb, trying to lessen the pain of being beaten by his teammate, who might be getting dumped at the end of the season there, going on the inside of Casey Lester for 18th place. Sylvia Rinaldi is she's in 30th place right now, sort of moving her way up through the field, and Laris Riu just passed Richard Dean MacGyver for 31st. So they're slowly working their way through the field. They haven't really done too much so far. It's still lap 9 of 60, so can't really say too much about that. 1/6 of the way through this race, here's Preston Bell to 14th place, trying to work around Dan Lechleiter. And Preston Bell's season has been nothing short of awful. He's really done nothing of note so far this season. This is actually one of the better runs that this car has seen all year. Stefan's Racing as a whole just seems like they've been off all season, and Preston Bell has definitely been affected by that. Here's Daniel Sharp leading a train of cars behind him. He's up to 4th place, and he's just holding his own up there, having a pretty strong run. He can't compete with the top 3, but he's definitely holding his own in the top 5, despite the train of cars that has formed behind him. Here's Ian Elias leading over Isaac Michaels and Lenny Jacobs, and not really much has changed up here. They all seem to be holding their own, and not much has really changed as far as the order of the top 3, but they've definitely been gapping the rest of the field. Oh, it looks like Preston Bell has a problem from 14th place, and he's going to spin that car. Greg Maddox spins as well. Maybe there's some... Oh, there goes Ingrid Hedeland as well. That's interesting. He might have slipped in some oil there, was dropping something on the track, and you see that car just abruptly goes left as if something broke in the suspension, but not sure why that explains the other car's spinning. He's going to park it there. He couldn't drive away. Under caution, Claire Aussier has problems in the number 0 car. She's going to pull that car to the apron and make it... I think she's going to make it back to the pits. And that car would be in the pits for an extended period of time. Ian Elias leads the field back to the green flag over Isaac Michaels. Preston Bell there is a lap down. He started on the inside of the field, and he's quickly losing ground there. Ian Elias is starting to gap the field again. Isaac Michaels really just doesn't seem to have anything to get around him, and as long as that's the case, looks like Ian Elias is going to run away with this race. Believe we are starting to approach an interesting pit window where drivers will be able to pit once and make it to the end of the race, but it's going to be close if that's going to be the case here. Here's Sylvia Rinaldi, and she's back in 35th place, battling with the likes of Tom Delgado. So, looks like this race went from bad to worse for Sylvia Rinaldi, and she just can't seem to catch a break. Her car is not strong enough to really push forward through the field, and your points leader here is not having a good run. On the other hand, Laris Riu is up to 22nd, so unlike Sylvia Rinaldi, her day's actually starting to get better. Battling there with Joe Craig, and she's passed a few cars. See Pete Maverick back there, and both of the forward fast cars. Now Dan Lechleiter is running up in 11th place, but he's got some forward damage on that car. Some of the front end is all pushed up, so we think he got into somebody either under caution or on pit road. That car is slightly damaged. Here comes Laris Riu, though. She got around her teammate, Ingrid Hadeland, and now she's going to try and make it three wide with Alex Posington and James Hewitt, already three wide up there with Casey Lester as well. And she just moved into 19th place with that, so Laris Riu is working her way up into race one territory with this quickly getting to be a good run here today. Here's a pass for, I believe this is ninth position, and it looks like the 44 car has developed a problem. Ryan Griffin has a problem. As you can see, just how fast he pulled away there. There goes Dan Lechleiter. That's for, I believe, 10th place. So that car is way off the pace. You can see just how fast he was able to complete that pass and how much momentum he's losing going up that elevation there. So Ryan Griffin definitely having some problems. I'm not sure. He hasn't reported that he's going to come into the pits. Now, Claire Aussier, speaking of the pits, has just come out of the pits. She's currently four laps down, and she's going to rejoin the race and not DNF. She'll continue on. Here's Chris Washer doing battle with Barry Juveneau. This is for the fifth position, so Chris Washer has really gotten his act together here in the last few races. He did DNQ for Mansfield, but with the win at Talladega and a possible top five effort here, it really looks like Chris Washer's fortunes have turned around, and he's doing an excellent job here today at Chicago. Now, Ryan Griffin has really dropped back. He hasn't brought that car into the pits for some reason. He's just kind of putzing around out there trying to figure out, I guess, see if the problem is going to fix itself, but clearly it isn't, so I'm not understanding why he hasn't pit that car yet. He's already back to about 15th place right now, and he's really just struggling here today. Barry Juveneau battling with Whitney Fuller again on the outside there, and looks like he's going to get passed by Whitney Fuller there. That is for the 7th. That would relegate the 65 car to the 7th position. So Whitney Fuller starting to move her way up. Maybe Barry Juveneau is developing a problem on his own. Here's Sylvia Rinaldi, and she's up to 20th place. So what I said about that car not having a good run, well, she is marching her way forward, and she's really doing a great job in this number 2 car now. This long green flag run has definitely helped her. Now looking back at the front end of the field, the front three and Preston Bell have gapped the rest of the field. Preston Bell has not dropped back, surprisingly. He's been running up with the top three. Isaac Michaels still has not made a move yet on Ian Elias. Perhaps he's saving his equipment for when he's going to do it later in the race or pull some fuel strategy to get around and take the win here today. Going back in the field, Ryan Griffin is back in 27th place by lap 30, so he's just fallen back completely. The crew is reporting that he is going to come into the pits this time, so he's finally deciding to let the crew take care of this problem instead of hoping it fixes itself. It clearly hasn't fixed itself, so he's going to bring his car into the pits this time there. He's slowing down, and he just pulled that car off, so Ryan Griffin would go a lap down in the process of getting whatever that was fixed. Never did say what was wrong with the car. Whitney Fuller doing battle with Daniel Sharp here for 4th place. Whitney Fuller has the advantage heading into this tight left-hand turn here. And Daniel Sharp is going to get a run on the high side. There he goes by Whitney Fuller. Excellent racing here. Back for 4th place. And Daniel Sharp will retake the 4th position. Sylvia Rinaldi breaking down from 20th place. She's got a problem. She's slowing down on track. And she's going to pull that car to the apron. Is she going to make it back to the pits? I don't know. It doesn't look like it. Sylvia Rinaldi slowing down. She's not sure what's wrong with that car. It sounds like it's something, I believe something in the suspension. And that car's going to stop there, and we've got a yellow flag on the track, lap number 32. Ian Elias leads the field back to the green flag, but he's got Ryan Griffin in front of him. Ryan Griffin still apparently having problems, and that's going to mean that Isaac Michaels and Daniel Sharp are going to go three wide for the lead there, and Daniel Sharp will take the lead coming into turn number two, but Isaac Michaels has the preferred line. Isaac Michaels going up the hill here is going to take over first place from Daniel Sharp. Looks like Ian Elias has fallen all the way back to at least fourth, because there's Whitney Fuller in third place. Oh, at least fifth now. Looks like Ryan Griffin really held up Ian Elias there. Here's Isaac Michaels leading the field over Daniel Sharp and a few other cars back there that managed to get around the lapped cars. And Isaac Michaels, that was the break he was looking for. Now putting Claire Aussier another lap down, but Isaac looks like back there in the pack. Isaac Michaels has a pretty big lead, but now just a few laps later, here comes Ian Elias once again trying to challenge on the bottom, but I don't know if he's fast enough to get around Isaac Michaels. This track, it does not have very many passing opportunities, especially if cars are equal like these two are. Ian Elias definitely caught up quite fast. It looks like Elias's car is just a bit faster, but I don't think he has a chance to make a move to pass Isaac Michaels with Isaac Michaels' defensive driving here today. Cameron Taylor running pretty well here. He's up in, he's up in the top 10, but that car doesn't seem like it's driving like it should. He just lost quite a bit of time to Corradovo's there, so he's going to pull that car off to the pits. He's reporting that a tire was going down, a right front tire was going down on the 77, so that's going to be the end of his day. Here's Daniel Sharp running in third place, trying to get around Claire Aussier on the inside, and he's just had a phenomenal race. Rens Brown Motorsports is actually switching to Mercedes for their home race in California, and they're going to run Mercedes for the rest of the season. So this is their last race with Lola, and Rens Brown Motorsports giving Lola a good run in their last run in the series. Isaac Michaels continuing to lead over Ian Elias as Elias is unable... Oh, no, that's not good. He just pulled to the inside, and Elias back to the lead. And there's something definitely wrong with the 4 car. That car is not doing what it should. It's really slow on the inside, but he is going to make it back to the pits. Unfortunately, the problems on that car would be terminal, and Isaac Michaels would drop out of the race from the lead. So now Ian Elias has a 10-second lead over the rest of the field. I believe he's got that 10-second lead over Daniel Sharp. So Sharp looking for a really good run here today in second place. He ran well here in 2012. I believe he finished in the top 15 in the 0-2 car. But Ian Elias appears to have the win handed to him. And now Barry Juveneau blows up from 7th place. So Juveneau's good run goes up in smoke, literally. He's going to pull that car to the inside and... he will stop on track. He is out of the racing line, so they will not throw a caution for this. Barry Juveneau stopped there, incredibly disappointed. A tough break for the 65 team there, having an excellent run. Here's a battle for second place. It looks like Lenny Jacobs is going to not be able to pass Daniel Sharp. Whitney Fuller even challenging there on the inside, but here he's going to get a little bit of a run on Daniel Sharp. I don't know if he's going to be able to take the position. Trying to make him on the inside, and I don't know if he did get it or not, because that camera was terrible, to be honest. Here's a bunch of cars back here. This is Pete Maverick, and all of these drivers are saving fuel. The fuel situation that I mentioned beforehand, with drivers making it on potentially one stop, that is going to come into effect. All of these drivers back here are trying to save fuel. Tom Delgado... his terrible day. I don't even remember where they took off his hood. I think he ran into somebody on pit road, but that doesn't matter because he's out of the race anyways. Something not right with that car. So Tom Delgado's day is done. First car, looks like Ramsey Cochiner was not able to save any fuel, so he's going to bring that car into the pits here on lap number 54. 6 laps to go. With 5 laps to go, here is Ian Elias with a 17-second lead over Lenny Jacobs, who's... Daniel Sharp, excuse me, who is in second place. This group back here, 39 car of Corradovo's, has developed this quite long train behind him. He's trying to save fuel. He's a couple laps short, and he's just saving as much gas as he can here with 5 to go. I don't think he's going to be able to make it. Some of the cars behind him might be able to, but I don't think that Corradovo's is saving enough to make it to the end. Oh, looks like Daniel Sharp is going to dive into the pits, Ike Durbin as well, but Lenny Jacobs is staying out. Lenny Jacobs has been saving fuel this entire run, we just heard. And here's Ian Elias. He passes the pits this time. That's three to go, and so does Lenny Jacobs, Whitney Fuller, and Chris Washer. They all stay out. Dan Leclerc comes into the pits. Nicholas Corradovos gives up on trying to save fuel. And with just two to go, Ian Elias brings his car into the pits. He did not save enough fuel. And Lenny Jacobs, let's see what he does here with two to go. Looks like he's going to stay out. So Lenny Jacobs has enough fuel, I believe, to make it to the finish. So what an interesting twist, as Lenny Jacobs has apparently saved enough fuel to bring his car around. Let's see, does he have enough fuel? Is he going to bring it into the pits? No. This is a group of cars in the back. These are some of the drivers we were saving. Ingrid Hadeland, Richard Dean MacGyver. There's a few others there. But Lenny Jacobs, up here in the front, has saved enough fuel to bring his car around, and he is going to take his first win of the season here at the Chicago Speedrome in just an absolutely interesting fuel strategy call. I'm surprised that Ian Elias didn't make this call, but Lenny Jacobs did. He made it work, and Lenny Jacobs is your winner here for race number one. Now looking at the results, Ian Elias, despite pitting, managed to finish second place ahead of drivers that didn't pit, like Ingrid Hadeland, Richard Dean MacGyver, Joe Craig, Greg Maddux, Pete Maverick, Alina Lazareva, Ben Worthington, and Nick Azure. All of those drivers stayed out and were able to save enough fuel to make it to the finish. Whitney Fuller finishes 11th place despite coming into the pits. Gaspar D'Souza, Alex Posington, and Casey Lester all stayed out and managed to make their strategy work out. Daniel Sharp, Ike Durbin, Dan Lecklater, Nicholas Corradovos, and Chris Washer all had to come into the pits, and Jacob Eichholt stayed out to capture a top 20 finish here today. Now for race number two, Brian Gallagher in the number 49 Katsev leads the field to the green flag, and he immediately starts to gap Greg Woodard, who apparently was sleeping on that start, and he's starting to pull away already. Oh, looks like Clara Kendall's going to make a move to the inside, but there's not too much grip down there, and Brian Gallagher already starts to pull away just a little bit coming out of turn number two. At the end of lap number one, you can see that he's already opened up quite a big gap on Clara Kendall there, so he's already starting to drive away into the sunset. Here's Wayne Newman and Jeff Fisher running 21st and 22nd. These are two PCC Lights teams that are one-offing in the Cup Series, Retro 90 Racing and Syzygy Engineering, and they're not doing too bad, to be entirely honest. 21st and 22nd isn't really that bad for teams that haven't had much success. Oh, looks like Candace Bowman got hooked there by Roy Cook. She hangs onto it, and that's actually going to turn into a position as she's on the inside of Brian Matthews there. Gonna try and get around him. Here's Wayne Coulter, who we last saw at Mansfield, in a surprising top five run. This is more of a bottom five run. He's running in 35th place right now, and just has not had the pace since they unloaded here. He figured he'd put part of his winnings towards coming here and competing, and well, he's not really doing too much of the competing part, but he's at least here at the track, and we appreciate that. Here's the one car, and you can just see the gap from Clara Kendall to the leader already on lap number four. So it looks like Brian Gallagher's already opened up like a 2-second lead or so on the rest of the field. Here's Kyle McWalla, lap number five, battle for fourth place, and he's going to get around Richard Hertz there, number 466. Richard Hertz has had a pretty good run here so far. He's kept that car in the top five. There's Dan Foray and Luke Pellerin. We haven't seen their names up front too often, but this is a good battle back here for fourth place, and it looks like Richard Hertz is going to take that back with a good run on the high side. Here, lap number seven, and there's Creeper Stevenson going a lap down already, so that just tells you how slow that car still is. Perhaps it's just how fast that Brian Gallagher is going, or possibly it's a combination of the two. Here's Gabriel Messina on lap number eight, and kaboom, that's the end of his day. Gabriel Messina would be the first car to retire from the race. He'd get back to the pits, and there would be no caution. Speaking of Creeper Stevenson, here's him being a nuisance to Ben Atkins. Look at all those positions he's losing on the bottom. One, two, three, four, five, six positions. Seven, eight. Okay, this is getting ridiculous. Creeper Stevenson would eventually move out of the way, and Ben Atkins would rejoin the fast line. Candace Bowman suffering some problems there. She's going to pull that car down to the apron on lap number 9, and she would make it back to the pits. Unfortunately, that would be the end of her day. So, tough break for Candace Bowman. She was really hoping to have a good run here today. She desperately needs it. Oh, I guess she's not going to make it back to the pits, but there would be no caution as... I stand corrected. There was a caution. Look at me. Oh, no! Brian Gallagher has a problem. Brian Gallagher, your leader under caution, has a problem on lap number 13, so that's going to be the end of his day. He had led every single lap up to that point. That's going to hand the lead over to Clara Kindall. So Clara Kindall leads the field back to the green flag. There's Matt Brinson, Creeper Stevenson, and John Kirkpatrick all laps down there. No surprise whatsoever. And Clara Kindall starting to gap the field a little bit. Greg Woodard, however, seems to be able to keep up with her a little bit. Richard Hurt's starting to drop back a little bit. But Clara Kindall has just... She hasn't had a good year, really. At least compared to last year, where she was winning left and right, at least during the second half of the season. She has not really continued that momentum onto this year. A team that has suddenly gained momentum, though, is Johnson Racing, after they restructured their engine package, and Cody Deke is running up in 7th place. So he's having a pretty good run. This is easily the best run he's had so far this season. Here's Stringfellow Vincent, one of the championship contenders, and he's running in 12th place, slowly working his way forward, battling with Josh Marshall right now. And there's Kurt Pliskin right behind him, one of the team cars that he has, trying to work around Josh Marshall on the bottom. Unfortunately, the bottom in turn 5 and 6 is just not that grippy, so he's going to lose a position to Kurt Pliskin there and fall back to 13th place. Now, Clara Kindall has gapped pretty much everyone except for Greg Woodard. Woodard appears to be holding pretty strong, so it's possible that we might have another Ian Elias Isaac Michaels situation here on our hands. Woodard, however, seems to be hanging just a little bit further back than Isaac Michaels, so he might just be conserving his equipment or something along those lines. Here's JC Carpenter in the number 79 car, and we normally don't see this car run very well, but he's currently in 19th place, doing battle for 19th with John Brockie there, and he's going to hold on to it. The Michelin tires on this number 79 car seem to be gripping pretty well as he falls back to 20th place, but the Michelin tires seem to be gripping very well on this number 79 car, and he's holding his own, definitely punching above his weight. Here's the 42 car of Jeff Fisher running in 15th place. Not really where I expected to see a PCC Lights regular team, but they're also punching above their weight, and they don't seem to be dropping back at all. So this car definitely seems to be suited for speedways, and it's been a while since we've seen a Fortner in the PCC Cup Series. Fortner's still around. Oh, there's Creeper Stevenson being a nuisance, and he's going to block Clara Kindall. Here comes Greg Woodard trying to make a move on the inside. Is this going to be a battle for the lead? He thinks better of it, and he's going to tuck in behind Clara Kindall, but he is right there now, right up on Clara Kindall's back bumper thanks to a back marker. Kyle McWalla now. He's having a good run here on the inside. He's going to try and catch Richard Hertz for third place, and he's actually going to make that work. And looks like Luke Pellerin's going to try and follow through as well. So now Kyle McWalla up to third place, and Luke Pellerin battling for fourth. I don't think he's going to be able to get it, as the bottom doesn't have quite a lot of grip in turn one and two. But nonetheless, looks like they're pulling even. So Greg Woodard making a move on the inside for the lead. Greg Woodard on the inside in turn five and six. Don't think there's too much grip down there, and he is going to drop back, but that was an ambitious move. If he had made that stick, that would have been quite impressive. But Greg Woodard definitely has the speed to get around and lead this race. He's poking his nose on the inside again, and it looks like Clara Kindall's going to hand it over to him. Clara Kindall hands over the lead, but she's dropping back a lot faster than I expected. That car does not sound healthy now. So Clara Kindall is now down on power from second place, and that does not bode well for Manticore Engineering. She's going to commit to the pits, and that car's going to... she's going to try and get that looked at. Tough break for Clara Kindall. She had such a good run going, and it looked like she was going to win this race, but unfortunately for her, her good run is going to end here. She's going to get her tires changed and head back out on track. They'd figure out what was wrong with the car. Kyle McCullough is 6 seconds behind Greg Woodard, so that is quite a gap that he has opened up. Here's Cale Bernfardt Jr. running in 27th place, and he's going to commit to the pits. Something is not right with that car. He's reporting a right front tire is deflating. So it's a good reason to dive into the pits, I suppose. Here's Stringfellow Vincent running in 10th place, and that car is slowing down pretty fast. That's not good for him. Stringfellow Vincent was having quite a great run, and he's pretty high up in points, actually. Unfortunately, that car is going to slow to a halt, and that will bring out the second caution of the day here on lap number 29 of 60. And just the car stops there on track, and he would have to get a tow back to the pits, and that would be his day done. Greg Woodard and the rest of the field make their way down to pit road, but Clara Kindall stays out. So Clara Kindall somehow playing that into her strategy, and now she leads the field back to the green flag as the leader. There's Cale Bernfardt Jr. on the tail end of the lead lap, and looking here, Clara Kindall trying to make a move around, but it looks like Greg Woodard is going to take the position away from Clara Kindall. So Greg Woodard to the lead, and Cale Bernfardt Jr. blows up right in front of the leaders. Talk about a massive inconvenience. Cale Bernfardt Jr.'s day would end from this, and he'd pull that car back into the pits. He'd make it back to the pits and take that car to the garage. Greg Woodard now, he's opened up. Look at that lead he's opened up from Cale Bernfardt Jr. blowing up in front of the leaders there. Stringfellow Vincent is back on the tail end of the lead lap now by virtue of starting on the inside line. Kyle McCullough now brings his car into the pits reporting some problems, and that's not good for him. That's going to put an end to his good run. And looking here, Greg Woodard is starting to lose quite a bit of time to Clara Kindall. He's stuck behind Stringfellow Vincent, who isn't exactly the fastest car on track right now. And he's really hoping he can get around Vincent before Kindall uses that to his advantage. Ben Atkins is slow. Looks like he's diving towards the pits. Oh, he runs into Alex Phillips, cuts him off, and he gets shoved up the track, goes into Kurt Pliskin, and that's going to be another caution. Magenta, Nelson, Andrew collected. And looks like Billy Ray James and John Kirkpatrick shoots through there without too much damage. What was he thinking? Going on board with Kurt Pliskin here, and you just see Ben Atkins was trying to make his way to the pits, but Alex Phillips for some reason had none of that, and Kurt Pliskin gets stuffed into the wall. He'll continue on without too much damage. Here's Greg Woodard leading on the restart lap number 39, and you got Clara Kindall, Barbara Burt up in the top five now, Dan Foray, and I couldn't make out the car in fifth place. It looked like Luke Pellerin. And he's starting to pull away now. Greg Woodard's starting to put a little bit of a gap between him and Clara Kindall. However, looking back in the field here, here's Creeper Stevenson. And, oh, they're four wide. That's never good. Creeper Stevenson is quite a bit of a nuisance. And coming down here, looks like we've got some contact up ahead. And, oh, we've got a couple cars into the wall and a couple cars around. And that's going to be caution number four on lap number 40. Taking a look, see here what happened. Oh, looks like JC Carpenter hit the wall, got into Damon Jones, Kyle McCullough involved. Kyle McCullough goes into the wall, Chris Winter goes into the wall hard. Alex Phillips might have gotten involved, and that's going to be the end of the day of JC Carpenter. Tough break for him. He had such a good run going on board with Ryan Matthews, and he's going to go to the bottom there. And he gets through cleanly, so good avoidance by Ryan Matthews going on board with Chris Winter, who for some reason is missing his hood. And he just had nowhere to go and got a little bit of air there. Chris Winter would pull that car into the pits, get that damage repaired, going on board with Alex Phillips now in the 71. And he is a ping pong ball. Hits the wall a couple times, and he miss it, actually. So a good job for him. He'd miss quite a lot of damage there. And Wayne Newman under caution would drop out due to engine troubles in that number 90 car, so tough break for him on the restart. Looks like Greg Woodard has quite a bit of a good run here over Clara Kindall. Barbara Burt still holding strong in third place, having a strong run for herself. And Greg Woodard not really escaping from Clara Kindall. So Kindall trying to make a move now to try and pass Greg Woodard again and get back to the lead. However, back in the pack, looks like Josh Marshall got hooked by Roy Cook, and a chain reaction. Looks like we've got a bunch of cars involved there. There's Kelly Blackwater, Kurt Pliskin, Wayne Coulter's involved, Luke Pellerin coming on board with Ryan Matthews, who is not so lucky. He got bounced into a few cars, and that's going to be the end of his day. Alex Phillips involved, Chris Winter, multiple cars involved in this accident coming out of turn number two, going on board with Wayne Coulter. See what he saw. Kelly Blackwater's in it. He's got a bit of damage there. Stringfellow Vincent was involved. And Wayne Coulter got hit there by Luke Pellerin, who suffered quite a bit of damage. And under this caution, Barbara Burt and Magenta Nelson Andrew would drop out due to some suspension issues in both of those cars. So Barbara Burt's top five run breaks down on her. Now Richard Hertz inherits the third position from her stricken teammate, and he's going to hold that position. Once again, Greg Woodard and Clara Kindall continue on and gap the rest of the field as they deal with lap traffic, and they're pulling away quite a bit. It looks like this race is going to be between either Greg Woodard or Clara Kindall at this point, as it seems that no one else really has anything for the top two. Richard Hertz is back there, but he's really been losing quite a bit of time. Here's Jeff Fisher, and he's up in fourth place. He's got a bit of rear end damage on that 42 car, but he's running in fourth place. A PCC Lights car is in the top five, something that I did not expect to see. I expected to see this car run maybe top 25, but not fourth place. He is putting together an excellent run, and something that Syzygy Engineering should be very proud of indeed. Wayne Coulter is also having a good run. He's up in 18th place. So the hoodless Wayne Coulter, despite being involved in that accident, is missing both his front end and rear end. And he's running up in the top 20. So having a strong run, finally. He's not that fast, but he's holding his own. He's still on the lead lap, which is more than some other drivers can say. And here's another guy having a good run for a small team, AJ Murphy. Surprised he even showed up to this race. He wasn't expected to show up, but he brought his Inglesby here. Perhaps a bit upset about missing Mansfield, but he's got that car up in the top 10 right now. He's running in 9th place. And we should see more of him once the series comes back from the European Tour. We're headed to Europe in just a few weeks here. So we'll see him probably back at Darlington. Looks like Cody Deak has managed to get around Jeff Fisher, and he's up in fourth place now. So a very strong run for the newly resurgent Johnson Racing, and Tom Wilson as well, having a good run up here. He's doing a pretty good job. He just made a pass for, I believe that was for sixth place around Lewis Jones there. Yeah, that's sixth place. Looks like we've got some smoke down there, and the caution has been thrown. Let's see what happened here. Wayne Coulter and Stringfellow Vincent make a get together, and he goes into the wall. Looks like Damon Jones also got collected, and Chris Benson, and that's going to draw the caution, the sixth caution of this race on lap number 53. And under caution, that would take out the 76 car finally, and the 96 would drop out as well from suspension problems. Dan Foray, the teammate of Greg Woodard. So Greg Woodard should be a little worried if he hears any rattling in his car. Looks like Richard Hertz tried to make a move there on the restart, but he couldn't do it. Clara Kindall trying to hold strong there in second place with just four laps to go now, lap 57. And tough break for AJ Murphy. He was running up in the top 10, but unfortunately his suspension is going to fail on him. A lot of suspension failures in this race for some reason. Cars might be hitting some bumps or something, but it looks like Greg Woodard is going to gap himself away from Clara Kindall come around the final turn, and Greg Woodard will take his first career PCC Cup Series win in race number two at the Chicago Speedrome here today in front of a home crowd. Quite a good win, an exciting win, a popular win for the crowd here today. Looking at the results, Clara Kindall hangs on to finish second. Richard Hertz, what a run for him. The German finishes in third place. Cody Deek has a very strong run in fourth place. He did quite a good job. All of Johnson Racing did a good job here today, at least the ones that finished. Jeff Fisher, talk about a PCC Lights driver punching above his weight in fifth place in the Cup race. Lewis Jones in sixth place, having, I believe, the best run of his season. Tom Wilson in seventh place. Roy Cook, Jordan Demas came out of nowhere to finish ninth place. Ben Atkins rounds out your top 10. Luke Pellerin fell back late to finish 11th place. Kurt Pliskin, despite some damage, finished in 12th. Sam Lussar, 13th. Chris Winter finishes 14th, despite missing his hood. John Bracci finishes in 15th. He had a strong run today. Stringfellow Vincent overcame some problems in the middle of the race to finish in 16th place. Chris Benson and Damon Jones, despite being involved in the accident with Wayne Coulter, finished 17th and 18th. Kyle McWella had some problems with his car, had to bring his car into the pits at least once, and finished in 19th. And Junior Hardern, despite being off the pace all day, snatches a top 20 away from a rapidly diminishing field due to some suspension failures. And for the point standings now, Alina Lazareva has taken the points lead over Laris Ryu by 4 points, 257 to 253 points. Stringfellow Vincent holds third place over Ryan Griffin by 4 points. Silvia Rinaldi has dropped from 1st to 5th in the points. Greg Maddox 6th. Lewis Jones tied with Duncan Cobb for 7th in points. Lenny Jacobs with that win vaults up to 9th. And Nicholas Corradovos rounds out the top 10, tied with Richard Dean MacGyver. Ben Atkins runs in 12th place. Ike Durbin 13th, despite missing Mansfield. Clara Kindall is 14th. Roy Cook and Ben Worthington tied at 15th in the points. Ingrid Hadeland 17th. Dan Lechleiter 18th. Daniel Sharp is 19th in points. And Joe Craig rounds out your top 20, being the only driver in the top 20 in points to have less than 200 points.